Germans are sandwiched between the British. The Albatross pitches up, zooms, then drops in behind the sudden and we stays. Chase. Richard Mayer will pitch up and loop back on the tail of the red-nosed albatross. Mayer yanks the stick back, throwing his SE5 into a dizzy acrobatic maneuver. He fires from point-blank range.
The
boss dives back into the fray. He fires his Spandau machine guns at the nearest SE5. Its engine pummeled. The British pilot dives out of the fight. The dogfight rages above no man's land. Boss handles the triplane superbly, pumping rounds to each of the attacking SE-5s, but it isn't enough.
The thing that's unfortunate for Boss is that he never really put enough planes out of commission to gain any sort of advantage. All the bullets he put in all those planes, he never drew a drop of blood from any of those opponents.
Triplane still circling around in the midst of six SEs, who were all firing at it as opportunity offered. And at one time I noted the triplane in the apex of a cone of traceables from at least five machines simultaneously, and each machine had two guns.
The British are dumbstruck by the skill and tenacity of the German pilot and the Fokker Tracker. But Werner Voss's luck is about to run out. Voss is here. British ace James McCutton is here. They'll streak in head on. But Voss doesn't see another SE5 coming in from the side. On the side, watches the bird. Then he opens fire, while slam into the triplane's cockpit and fuselage. Boss stays alive. For the first time in the battle, he takes no evasive action. Then Arthur Wiestig dives on Boss from behind. He empties his Pecker's machine guns into the triplane. Boss does little to avoid the deadly arm of bullets.
Given how much he straightened up and how the ferociousness of his maneuvering had faded, he was looking and he was probably starting to have some difficulty maintaining consciousness.
He stays. Fires another burst in the triplane, then pulls up. James McCutton is the only pilot to witness Boss's final moments.
When I next saw him, I saw him go into a fairly steep dive, and so I continued to watch. And then saw the triplane hit the ground and disappear into a thousand fragments. For it seemed to me that it literally went nowhere.
After 10 minutes of ferocious combat, Werner Voss is dead at age 20. The German ace shot holes through every plane that attacked him, but incredibly, all returned to base.
As long as I live, I never forget to have a that way. This flying is wonderful, it's a courage magnificent, and in my opinion, he is the bravest German air.
German pilots and planes were always on the cutting edge of tactics and technology. They were a formidable foe for the Americans who took to the skies above France in 1918. The United States Army Air Service was equipped and trained by the French. Though some pilots had flown the French Lafayette Escadrille earlier in the war, most had no combat experience. America's first dogfighters would be tested as never before. September 14, 1918, Mars Patrol France. American pilot Arthur Raymond Brooks, in a formation of six Span 13s, patrols over the Western Front. Soon, they spot three formations of German Fokker D-7s in the distance. The Americans move in. Instinctively, Brooks checks six and sees a formation of 12 enemy Fokkers.
I saw them as they neared us, but had no time to move the leader or fly, other than by his nose and down, gaining speed as I turned to the right over his head and into the Fokkers.
Brooks's abrupt maneuver separates him from his flight. Four of the German planes continue on to attack the rest of the Spads. The eight stays right above the barrier. The sky explodes into a furious and deadly contest. September 14, 1918. The American pilot, Arthur Raymond Brooks, wins straight into the fight of his life. German Fokker D-7s.
I was scared, but in spite of much high tension and yelling at the top of my voice, I calculated that I'd make sure of my trap, I suppose, that I would hit as many Fokkers as possible before the inevitable.
Brooks is up against a three-point the Fokker D-7.
It is 100% universally felt that the Fokker D-7 was the best fighter aircraft in World War I. It had a wing that was thick, which allowed it to maneuver very quickly.
Brooks's Span 13 with a 220 horsepower Ismano Suiza 8BC engine and a top speed of 138 miles per hour is sturdy, but plagued with engine problems. Both planes are armed with two forward-firing machine guns. The SPAD is faster and better in a dive, but the Fokker D-7 is more agile in a turning fight. Brooks initiates wildly evasive maneuvers, skidding, looping, and diving, anything to prevent the circling Fokkers from getting a clean shot.
Brooks was probably alternating between panic and the coolness of desperation. His mind was fixed on a number of things at once.
Adrenaline surges as he fights to stay alive amid the chaos of swirling airplanes. Suddenly,
one farmer dies fortune in a head-on pass. Desperate to save fuel and ammunition, Brooks heads directly at the water, intent on ramming the turtle.
It seems like a real dramatic last ditch move. No telling what damage it'll inflict on the water, or something like that.
Just before the impact, the German peels under and dives away. Brooks reverses and to survive, he must keep moving. Another bomber pours in head on. Brooks speeds by.
I turn immediately on the other, feeling that a vigorous offense was the best defense.
Brooks is huge. A farmer is firing on him here. In this kind of dogfight, Brooks must take a shot at every opportunity. As the German dives on him, Brooks will skid out of the stream of bullets. Then, when the farmer passes underneath, Brooks will roll over the top of his enemy and bring his guns to bear. The German pours in. Brooks falls hard back on stick. The span keeps skyward.
I had just enough time to dip enough to see his features before I fired incendiaries, and he was a flame.
All he had to do was pull himself across, not having to slow down or line shoe slice, because Rick has been right across the plane.
It's a brilliant move. Brooks's two .303 caliber Vickers make quick work of the bomber. One down, but he's facing seven. Brooks spots a bomber at 2 o'clock and starting a pass.
Now it's purple vision. Realizes he was an answer. The challenge to break somebody else was right there.
Brooks clanks to the mic and peppers the water with machine gun fire.
Germans could not shoot at me without being in their own way most of the time, or bringing one of their own aircraft into the line of fire.
Germans just saw two of their squadrons go down. They're angry now. Terms of flying more aggressively, I'm sure the same cut. We're going to face this SOB right now.
The six other bombers thrown in like angry ones, determined to knock the smash out of the sky. September 14, 1980. American pilot Arthur Raymond Brooks has knocked out two German bomber D-7s. Six remaining fighters close in. Brooks must stay aggressive and constantly on the move, never remaining a stationary target for long.
One of the things we typically do when in an outnumbered situation, we want to switch them on. We'll work on them, switch back to somebody else.
White tracer ribbons were cut through between my wings often, so close that if I reached out my hand, the stream of bullets would have cut off.
Brooks pitches up to evade another attack. As he rolls over the top, his engine spirals, his prop windmills slow. He's run out of fuel in his main tank. He's terminal tanks located in the center section of the top wing.
I stare at the blade. I instinctively nose down just as an enemy burst swept from my forehead, shattering my windshield and clattering to my right gun, rendering it useless except for simple shots.
He's in what's called the unspecified tension inside the field. It's a burn. You don't have time to think too much, so it's very heavy. So, yeah. What happens if you fall back to your training? The situation like this one.
Brooks manages to restart the engine. As he dives for airspeed, he gets lucky.
Two more Bosch planes in their tactical work, pounded in the way of my now single line of fire.
Brooks opens up. White hot incendiary bullets, a new kind of ammunition designed to set enemy aircraft on fire, rip through the bombings.
This was still too much attention to suit me. I figured the danger was greater for me now than the whole swarm, because there was less chance of the Germans getting it the way.
Brooks decides to exploit the only advantage his SPAD 13 has over the Fokker D7. Dynamic speed. His 220 horsepower SPAD can outdive and outrun the Fokker D7. He bobs and weaves as the Germans block traces.
Knows that it's safe. Sorry, Shaq should. If he continues to turn it up, so he starts to get the airplane and just make himself unpredictable. And now the thing goes
fire. The Germans break off. The grueling dogfight is over.
I don't know how I got back. One incendiary bullet burned itself out in the main spark by a Halloween. Five bullets went through my fuselage and 4 inches of my back. Holes were scattered all over my horse pad. The aircraft had to be salvaged.
During the incredibly intense action, Brooks has fought off 8 for 2 seconds, the most advanced fighter, while down 4.
By the end of the war, you had aircraft with 200 plus horsepower engines, you had aluminum frames on the aircraft, whereas before everything was wood, you had supercharged engines, and you had pilots using parachutes and oxygen. Like it or not, war enhances technological growth out of necessity.
Thank you.
360. He never strikes Pearl Harbor, and America is at war. The aircraft carrier Enterprise leads the U.S. Navy as it struts back. Now, Enterprise is about to face a massive Japanese fleet at midnight. USS Enterprise, a fighting city of steel. She's the most revered and decorated ship of World War II. Of this, 163,000 in the skies. The Enterprise's enemies could be anywhere. USS Enterprise find their target in the North Pacific. They are Japanese carriers Kaga and Akagi, part of an enormous Japanese fleet. Japanese zero fighters have been distracted with earlier assaults. They tear apart the slower planes, but leave their home carriers unprotected. Single bomb is dropped. The Oak Reader flyboys and Enterprise are looking for vengeance. They are dying in the trap. Flashback. The battle called Midway had actually begun 24 hours before. On June 3rd, 1942, USS Enterprise sailed 900 miles from her home base in Hawaii. Accompanied by fellow carriers Rosa, she's heading for a tiny American outpost on a remote digital call in London. 175 miles west, a Japanese carrier steering southeastward on a collision course. Support ships, 233 carrier aircraft, 127 land-based aircraft on Midway Island, and 8 submarines, outnumbered 2-1. 6 months after Pearl Harbor, this is all that is left of America's Navy. Carriers were not present in the sneak attack.
He said, "We have no idea what we've done. We're definitely disappointed and worried."
Those aircraft carriers come back to make a bit of a pain in the neck of themselves by attacking the Japanese in February at the Marshall Islands.
USS Enterprise strikes the Japanese force occupying Wake Island. And a week after that, Enterprise strikes the Marcus Island, just 1,000 miles from Tokyo. Then in April, Enterprise escorts USS Morgan to the Hilo Bay in his mainland Japan. B-25 bombers launch the bomb and drop bombs on Tokyo and Sakura.
Japanese realize
we're
allowing
USA. Say that Midway has a drastic water shortage. Within 24 hours, the codebreakers have their answer. The Japanese Navy sent a code message reporting a water emergency on target AF. Nimitz is right. AF is Midway Island. Admiral Nimitz has evened up the odds. The Japanese Navy is arriving in full force. But the Americans will be waiting. And the U.S. is a true 360-degree battle. Your target, Midway Island, objective, protect the American base and inflict as much damage as possible on the superior Japanese fleet. Strategy, ambush, air, sea, and sub attacks. Nimitz knows that the Japanese will approach Midway from the northwest, so he sends his aircraft carriers, Enterprise, Hornet, and Yorktown, to a stage 200 miles north east of the island. When the Japanese carriers come within range, American bombers will attack. And all signs point to the 4th of June as the day the enemy ships will reach the battle zone. Dawn, June 4th, 1942. It's clear and quiet as USS Enterprise floats near the exact center of the Pacific. Too late.